disquieted in me. Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance.
O my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore will I remember thee from the land of Jordan and of the Hermons, from the hill Mizar.
Deep calleth unto deep at the noise of thy waterspouts. All thy waves and thy billows are gone over me.
Yet the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto the God of my life.
I will say unto God my rock, why hast thou forgotten me? Why go I mourning because of the oppression of the enemy?
As with a sword in my bones, mine enemies reproach me, while they say daily unto me, where is thy God?
Why art thou cast down, O my soul? And why art thou disquieted in me? Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise him who is the health of my countenance and my God. Shall we pray? Father, we realize that there are many, many here today whose soul is cast down or troubled. There's an unrest. It seems, Lord, that there's so much pressure. And sometimes, Lord, we can't see your hand at work. And those around us often taunt us, saying, where is your God now? But Lord, we pray that you will bring us to that place of just trusting in you and hoping in you. Knowing, Lord, that even in this situation, you are going to cause us to triumph, and you will bring your victory. And so we look to you today, Lord, for your help, for your strength, for your guidance, that we might walk, Lord, in your path. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. As we are going through the Bible, we have currently arrived at Matthew chapter 6. And so tonight we'll be studying the 6th chapter of Matthew. We're in the heart of the Sermon on the Mount. And so we encourage you to read it over. And then join with us this evening as we gather to worship the Lord and to study what Jesus has to say to us concerning our trusting in God and concerning the way we live the righteous life. This morning we'd like to draw your attention to the 25th verse of Matthew chapter 6. As Jesus said to his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought, or do not be overly concerned, or don't worry. Take no anxious thought. Don't be anxious for your life. What you are going to eat, or what you are going to drink. Nor do not take anxious thought for your body, what you are going to wear. Is not your life more than meat, and your body more than clothes? It is interesting that the things that people are usually most anxious about are the physical things of their lives. What I'm going to eat, what I'm going to drink, what I'm going to wear. These are the things that seem to occupy so much of our thought processes. Listen to the world around you. Listen to their conversations. Listen to what they are talking about. What are the subjects, the common subjects? What we're going to eat, some new recipe, some new restaurant. What we're going to drink, or some new dress, or some new slacks that we have seen, or new style of shoe, or whatever, what we're going to wear. And it seems like the world is only interested in the physical body appetites. As we deal with our body needs, that seems to occupy the minds of most people. But Jesus said that should not be so with the disciples of his. For life is more than food, and the body is more than just the clothes that you wear. We always see those who are worried about where the next meal is going to come from, or just what shall I fix the family for dinner tonight, you know. And that occupies so much of the thought processes, so much of your time. How often we hear, but I just don't have anything to wear. There's more to life than food and clothes. You remember the story in the Bible, Luke tells us in chapter 10, that there were two sisters, Martha and Mary, and Jesus had come for a visit to their home. And Martha was busying herself with the physical things, straightening up the house, fixing the food and the physical aspects. Whereas her sister Mary just sat at the feet of Jesus, listening to him, worshiping him. Finally, Martha got up so upset, she said, "Jesus, send Mary out here to help me. She's left all of this work to me while she just sits there." And Jesus said, "Martha, Martha, you're troubled about many things. But Mary has actually chosen the better part, and it's not going to be taken from her." The one was interested in the physical. The other was interested in the spiritual. And Jesus said the one who had chosen the spiritual had chosen the better part. But I wonder how often we're not seeking to just serve the Lord with the physical things. And that so much of our mind and so much of our energy is devoted to taking care of ourselves physically, and often to the neglect of the spiritual, often to the neglect of just sitting and listening to Jesus. It's always a sad day when the physical aspects of your life interfere with your relationship with him. Now, Jesus, having said to his disciples, "Don't be worried about what you're going to eat or what you're going to wear," gave to them basically the cure for worry. The next time you seem to be worried about your food, what you're going to eat, Jesus said, consider the birds of the air. They do not plow the fields. They do not plant seeds. They do not gather the harvest and put it in the barn. And yet, your heavenly Father feeds them. Now note, he is your heavenly Father. He's not the bird's heavenly Father. He is the bird's creator. And he watches over his creation. Jesus said, there's not a sparrow that falls to the ground, but what your Father isn't cognizant of it. He's your Father. He sees that his creation is taken care of. The birds have something to eat. And if your Father will see that the birds are fed, you can make certain that as your child, he is going to see that you are fed. Now, Jesus is not saying that they should not plow, they should not sow seed, they should not gather the harvest into the barn. He's not saying that. He's just saying that those are not the things that you should be giving your thoughts to, being worried as you cultivate the soil and plant the seed, whether or not you're going to have a good crop or whatever, and to be so concerned, always thinking about these things. They should not be the paramount issues of your mind or of your life, for life is much more than just eating. I love to work in the garden. I love to get my hands in the soil and work the soil. I love husbandry. And I love gardening. I love planting the seeds. I love watching the plants come up. There's something fascinating to it all. And when I do that, maybe I'm a little weird, but as I plant a seed, I marvel at God's creative genius. For I realize that in that little seed, there is the DNA code that God has designed to reproduce, to make a plant that would bring forth fruit, that will have seeds with the same kind of DNA genetic code to create the next plant and the next plant. And I just marvel at God's genius in creation. To realize that encoded in that little seed, all of the planning, all of the formula, for the roots to go down, for the shape of the leaves, for the shape of the plant, for the taste and the whole, it's all there. All designed. And I just find that gardening is a great way of just getting your mind on the Lord and the things of the Lord. And it to me, is great. Jesus isn't saying, don't plow, don't plant. He's not saying, just, you know, lie there and open up your mouth and I'll come and take care of you. But he is saying, don't let that be the chief occupation of your mind. Don't let that dominate your thought processes. Your Father takes care of the birds. And he said, are you not much better than they? Now, in God's mind, you are. Maybe not in the minds of the environmentalist. Spotted owl is really more important than you or your job. Abort babies, but save the spotted owl, or save Willie. Burn the houses, but save the gnat catcher. But as far as God is concerned, you're much more important than they. Because you see, they are only God's creation. You're God's child. And as the child of God, you're so important to him. Jesus then declared the worthlessness of worry. It doesn't really accomplish anything. Which of you, by worrying, can add 18 inches to their height? Maybe you're short. And you think, oh, I'm so short. Oh, that's terrible. I'm so short. Oh, I wish I were taller. People are going to take advantage of me. And you might just, you know, that may be the thing that every time you look in the mirror, you think, oh, how short I am. And you're always thinking about that. Walk down the street, you see people taller, and you go, oh, I wish I were taller, you know. Well, it's not going to make you any taller, worried about how short you are. And that's what Jesus is saying. It's really occupying your mind and your thoughts with things that don't produce any results. Worry is non-productive. It doesn't change things. And then he brings up the issue of clothes. The next time you're prone to be worried about how you are dressed, or what you're going to wear, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They do not toil, nor do they spin. Now, in those days when Jesus was saying this, most of the clothes were handmade. Not only that, the cloth from which the clothes were made was handmade. They would have a spindle there in the house. And a part of the occupation of the young girls was to spin the wool into a yarn that they might make it into a fabric and then from the fabric make their clothes. So there was a lot of toil, a lot of spinning. But consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They do not toil, they do not spin. Many believe that Jesus was referring to the beautiful anemones that grow so profusely there in the Holy Land. During the spring, the hillsides, the fields turn a beautiful crimson red, deep red color as these anemones begin to just burst out and blossom, covering the hillsides. It looks like there's just a red carpet on the hillside. Absolutely glorious, beautiful. And some think that Jesus was referring to those anemones when he said, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They don't toil, they don't spin. And yet Solomon, with all of his glory, with all of his riches, was not arrayed like one of these. He didn't have clothes that beautiful, colors that vivid. And then Jesus said, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is gone, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Now, the argument that Jesus uses is from the lesser to the greater. If your Father feeds the birds, surely he's going to feed you. If your father will clothe the grass of the field with such beautiful colors, surely he'll take care of you and see that you are clothed. And then Jesus shows us really the cause for worry when he said, O ye of little faith. You see, faith and worry are mutually exclusive. If you have real faith in the providential care of God, you're not going to worry. Worry indicates my lack of faith that God is in control and he is going to take care of it. Somehow the concept of the Heavenly Father has not really sunk in to your mind. He is the Lord of all creation, but he is your Heavenly Father. Jesus had just taught them to pray in the earlier part of the chapter. Our Father, which art in heaven. Relationship, that's the all-important thing. It's your relationship to God. And if you are a child of God, if you enjoy that kind of a relationship with God, then you've got nothing to worry about. During the Depression years, I can remember that they used to sing a chorus in church. I was just a little guy, but I can remember. And during the Depression years, when things were really hard, they used to sing, Cheer up, ye saints of God, there's nothing to worry about. There's nothing to make you feel afraid. There's nothing to make you doubt. Remember that God is still on the throne. So why not trust him and shout? Because you'll be sorry that you worried at all tomorrow morning. Just, you know, if you have that consciousness of God as my Heavenly Father, if you have that relationship, God is my Father. I am his child. He loves me. He is concerned for me. He cares about me. And he is going to see that my needs are all going to be met. I don't have to worry about my needs. I don't have to worry about whether or not God is going to take care of things. He's my Father. I know he will. But it's relationship. Now, there are some who have a real right to worry because they don't have that kind of relationship with God. They are just his creation. But he's not their father. They haven't come into that relationship with him. For you come into that relationship with him through Jesus Christ. But as many as received him, Jesus Christ, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to those who believed upon his name. So if you've come to believe upon the name of Jesus Christ, there has been given to you that power to become a son of God. And if you're a son of God, then you've got nothing to worry about. Because your Father is going to see that all of your needs are taken care of. Those that worry about the mundane things of this life, such as food and clothes, Jesus said you're no better off than the heathen, because that's what occupies their minds. The unregenerate world around you, in which you live, are always thinking about the body needs and appetites, drives, hungers. After all of these things, he said, do the Gentiles or the heathens seek? But you, your chief concern, what should be occupying your mind is not what I'm going to eat, what I'm going to drink, what I'm going to wear, but your relationship with him. You, he said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then God will take care of all of the other things. You see, it's a matter of priority. And when God is first in your life, when you're a child of God and he's first in your life, then he will take care of the rest. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to spend anxious thought concerning these things, because you are a child of God and he's going to see that these other things are taken care of. Many people go through life accomplishing absolutely nothing because their priorities are all messed up. They spend all of their time, thought, and energy in things that will pass away. In things that are not eternal. Eating, drinking, clothes, they all are going to pass away. And yet, that's what people give themselves to: thought, energy, time, worry, consideration. And thus, they spend their life without ever accomplishing anything. Their life is a total waste. Now, Jesus declares, therefore, don't worry about tomorrow. When the issues arise, they'll be taken care of. Keep your priorities straight. Keep them right. And God will take care of the rest. You know, this past week, we've been cruising, and the stories they tell about the food is right. It is great, and it is plentiful. And I hate to admit it, but I have put on a few pounds this past week. And so when I got ready for church this morning, as I buttoned my jacket and looked at myself in the mirror, I saw how that the button was sort of pulling and there are a few wrinkles here. And I thought, oh no, you know, and oh look at, oh my, you know, the collar wasn't setting quite right on my shirt. And I started worrying about the way I looked, the way the suit was fitting. And as I started to worry, I had just finished my notes on the message. And I laughed. I said, look, I've just finished the message on don't worry about how you look, how your clothes fit. And what am I doing? Looking in the mirror and worried. Oh my, it's there. It's always there. It's something that you have to, you know, you have to just really concentrate on that. Because those are the things that can come in and create a disturbance. You feel, oh, I look so, you know, so heavy in this suit. I don't like that. And you can get into that so easily. I don't think I'll go to church today. I just don't look good in this dress, you know. And you know, you let the physical interfere with your spiritual. And that's what Jesus is talking about. Realize that the spiritual part of your life is by far more important than the physical aspects of your life. And don't let your mind and your thought be taken up in these physical things. They're all temporal. They're all passing. But take thought of the eternal things, your relationship with God and all, and God will take care of these other things. Right priority. That's what's important. Father, teach us. It's so easy, Lord, to get caught up in how our clothes fit, how we look in them. Is the color right? Is it pressed? Or, Lord, these things just can be nagging little concerns that occupy our thought and that so often take our thoughts away from you. Help us, Lord. We need your help. Help us to put you first and to keep you first. Help us, Lord, to seek you first. Be more interested in the things of the Spirit, your kingdom, righteousness, and leave the other things to you. Knowing, Lord, that when we have that right relationship with you, everything else will fall in its proper order and place. Help us. Lord, we need your help. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we stand? I would imagine that it would help if some week we would just keep a diary, and at the end of the day, as we look over the day that has just gone by, and try and prioritize our thinking, or at least consider what it was that we accomplished physically and what we accomplished spiritually. How much emphasis did we put upon the physical aspect of our life, and how much emphasis upon the spiritual aspects? I imagine that many of us would be shocked of how much time and energy and thought we devote to things that have already passed and are gone, and how little we spent on that which is eternal. May God help us to seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness. Then we won't be worried about what we're going to eat or drink or wear, because God will take care of that. The Lord bless thee,
the Lord bless thee
and keep thee.
Now, on behalf of The Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.